Hi, good evening, everybody, and welcome to GSA lecture series. Really happy this evening to introduce a friend of mine and also a friend of the GSA, Manijeh Verghese, and she's joining us actually from Greece. She's based in London, but she's currently on vacation in Greece before returning to the AA. And I had the good fortune of meeting Manijeh actually at the GSA. Leslie Locco had invited us both to be part of the International Critics Week in 2018. And I think everybody involved with that really had an extraordinary experience on so many levels and introduced a really quite extraordinary community of people to each other. And, you know, always try and check Manijeh out when I'm in London and we keep in touch, and really so excited to have her talking this evening and making her presentation New Models, which we're really looking forward to. Just a bit of kind of housekeeping before I kind of introduce her formally. Just make sure you keep your mics off. You know, sometimes people accidentally turn them on and we, you know, hear mum making the dinner in the kitchen and the dog barking and all the rest of it. So try and keep your mic off. And also there's going to be, you know, opportunity for questions and answers at the end. Patricia Bandura, one of our master students, is going to be coordinating that. So if you have any questions during Manijeh's presentation, anything that comes up that, you know, you're curious about, just, you know, drop it into the chat on the right-hand side of your screen. And then Patricia will know that you've got a question to ask, and she's going to be able to kind of, you know, introduce you to ask it. Or if you're shy and don't want to ask it, she can ask it for you. And Manijeh is really keen to respond to any questions. And I know some students have already prepared some questions for her. So I'm looking forward to not only her presentation, but, you know, your feedback and your response and your comments or the questions that you have for her. So just to introduce Manijeh, she is the head of public programs at the Architectural Association in London. She's also a unit master of Diploma 12, not sure how she juggles that. She's a seminar leader for the AA professional practice. She's a founding director at Unseen Architecture, and she was a co-curator of the British Pavilion at the 17th Venice Architecture Biennale. She's led postgraduate and undergraduate design studios at the AA and Oxford Brookes, and she's taught across workshops and courses all over the AA, all over the UK and abroad. And she's worked for some really interesting practices, John Pawson and Foster and Partners, and been involved with publishing. We're really quite a prolific presence in the world of architecture, and we're really, really happy to have her as a friend at the GSA. Unfortunately, she wasn't able to join us. She was planning to actually physically come to South Africa, but as some of you may know, the AA's recently changed its director. So I think they're all needed on deck early on. So it precluded her joining us. But we really are hoping to have her come and join in some of the activities and programs we have next year. Now things are opening up. So I'm going to hand you over to Manijeh now. Manijeh, welcome. Thanks so much for agreeing to come and share some of your thoughts and your reflections and your work with us. And we're really looking forward to your talk. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Mark. Hopefully everyone can hear me. That was a very generous and wonderful introduction, and I'm really looking forward to not just presenting what I've put together, but also much more so to the conversation to follow. So I'll just share my screen. Oops. Sorry, you'd think after 2 years I'd be a pro at this.
We can see it clearly.
Great. I'm sorry, I just had to remember to share sound because I have like one clip that has audio. But anyway. So yeah, to start with, I thought when planning tonight's lecture, I would call it New Models, which has not only been the title of a lecture series that I've run as part of the public program over the last 2 years, but it's also become a way to help me understand how I can shape my own practice and unify the different strands of things that I've been doing as a response to what I see and what so many people see as the urgent need for systemic change. So first of all, I want to say how excited I am to be back at the GSA, at least virtually, if not physically right now, since it's a really special place for me, and visiting Johannesburg and the school for the first time really transformed my practice in so many ways. As Mark mentioned in the introduction, back in 2018, we were both invited for the first International Critics Week, at the GSA by Leslie Loco. And this was a real turning point in my career, since the trip shaped so many of my ideas and introduced me to so many wonderful minds that became lifelong friends. And I was also just incredibly impressed by the projects I saw presented across the different design studios that really took the same kind of Western precedents and theories that had like shaped my education, but turned them on their heads. And they became all sorts of things, from scripts for decolonization or a new way to kind of read a different type of landscape. And then they were merged with contextual references, concepts, and methodologies in a way I had never seen before. And that first encounter brought me back to Johannesburg many times in 2019 to teach a series of workshops and seminars with Unit 12 that at the time was being run by Samea Valley. And that was an amazing experience for me to get to work alongside students at the GSA who were using, in the unit, they were using language as a tool to rethink and speculate on future territories. And I was able to witness firsthand the production and participate in the process behind these projects. They really helped me understand how my own identity and lived experience could inform my practice in ways I'd previously never thought possible. So it was a real learning experience for me as well. So earlier this year, when Mark invited me to present my research and practice as part of your lecture series, I was really delighted both to come back and speak to my friends and extended family here at the GSA, but also flattered. I organize lectures for a living at the AA, and so most of my time is spent doing what Mark just did, introducing people. And so much of my practice has been about creating platforms for other people to share their work. So it's not often that I get to share what I do. So this preparing for this has provided me with space to reflect on the different things that I do and how they constitute a practice, which is something I think about all the time. So I'm really grateful for this opportunity, but would really welcome all of you asking me questions to help me figure this out collectively after the lecture is over. So yeah, to start with, I thought I would talk about the AA Public Program, which I've worked on in different capacities since 2014. And I guess like I started by curating the extensive program of lectures, and my role has then grown over time to include designing and organizing exhibitions, performances, parties, special research projects, and now trying to develop strategies to unify all the school's public-facing activities, from our global membership to different forms of outreach to widen participation. So working on the public program has always been exciting, and it's something I love because it's free for anyone to attend. And due to the number of events and exhibitions which happen at any time at the AA, which can be quite challenging to produce at times, what I really love about it is that it's a free form of education across different scales and disciplines. And it's unified in how each element of the program actually relates back to architecture. So on the screen now, you can see an exhibition from 2019 in our gallery in Bedford Square. So we haven't been able to do exhibitions in the gallery because of COVID. So I'm looking forward to this coming academic year, which starts in a few weeks' time, and the return of cultural life to the buildings. But this was part of our architecture and translation project that was trying to find a wider vocabulary to talk about space through learning from the nuance and knowledge embedded in other languages. And a more recent exhibition, so over the last year, while we couldn't do exhibitions in the AA itself because of testing requirements and things like that, we were actually given an amazing temporary space in the former Habitat showroom just up the road from the AA, so on Tottenham Court Road in London. And we over here, we had an exhibition called A Momentum of Light earlier this year in February. And that explored the interplay between natural sunlight, vernacular architecture, and everyday life in the West African nation of Burkina Faso. And the exhibition was a series of images captured by the photographer Iwan Bon during his travels with architect Francis Carey through Burkina Faso. And that they took this trip in March 2020. And Iwan Bon was commissioned by Zumtobel, the lighting company, initially to make some photographs for like a big anniversary of theirs for their annual report. But the photographs and stories that Iwan and Francis managed to capture together were so captivating that they transformed them into an exhibition of large-scale prints and light boxes, which you can see in this image. And they were initially installed in Switzerland, but then traveled to the AA to be exhibited in this space. And it was really great to actually have like the shop front to take exhibitions out of like the kind of Georgian facades of the AA that you often feel like you can't enter, and put them like almost onto the street. And so that's something that kind of really challenged the way we've been doing exhibitions at the AA that I hope we can continue going forward. So one of the things I've tried to do with the public program is not just to see it as a way to test ideas that then can translate into the full-time curriculum of the school, but also to engage with diversity in different forms to expand the discipline of architecture and the AA itself into a more inclusive space. And so this began with AAXX 100, which was a multi-year project to celebrate the centenary of women at the AA who've too often been hidden from history. And this project culminated in 2017 with a collection of historical and critical writing, an exhibition, and an international conference. And in parallel, I introduced an open call to inform the contents of the public program so that students could propose what kinds of lectures and exhibitions they'd like to see, but also that they can organize and run them as well. And they really were kind of keen for architects working in interesting ways across the world to be invited, who would really reflect where they were from and inspire them in terms of what they could do following graduation. So not inviting the usual suspects is something that was really important. So this led to a series that we introduced in 2019 called New Canonical Histories that invited architects and artists, as well as theorists, who were questioning, shifting, expanding, or rejecting the existing art and architectural canon in order to write new histories or retell history from a very different perspective. And each lecture was imagined as a kind of chapter in a book that collectively would redefine art and architectural history. And it covered topics at the intersection of gender, race, identity, power, climate, labor, politics, and history. And so kind of from there, that became this series, New Models. And in the wake of the Black Lives Matter protests and so much other kind of unrest and inequality that are present in the spaces we occupy today, this series invited architects as well as practitioners from other disciplines to discuss how their work can really change the models around which society is organized. And these were definitely framed as more of conversations, because it's not something that any one architect or any one person can do as a kind of collective effort to slowly shift things. And each of the conversations addressed, like, how do we shift power structures, socioeconomic forces, and structural inequalities present in society today to give us new tools to rethink the world around us. So over 2 years, the series invited so many inspiring individuals and collectives who've been doing amazing work to discuss how we can transform society slowly but surely through these new models for redesigning institutions, redressing who has access to funding, reversing the lack of representation in public art, embracing physical and digital spaces of collective care, designing community-led forms of practice, and addressing the interconnected crises threatening the future of our planet through ecology. And that's just to name a few of the many topics that were covered. And I guess at a time when we're facing so many multifaceted and interconnected crises, whether they're ones of climate, racial and systemic injustice, or public health with the pandemic, this series not only proposed different strategies for change, but created a sense of community, solidarity, and above all, hope for a more inclusive future, which felt much needed, especially like at a time when we were all sitting isolated in our homes because of the pandemic, and everyone was joining these lectures on Zoom. And it just kind of enabled us to come together in different ways that I hadn't ever imagined we would, but it was like trying to find the silver lining in an otherwise kind of bad situation. So this series is now developing this coming academic year into a program called New Standards. And that will really kind of aim to identify and confront some of the barriers to architecture, its education and practice, and consider how they can be opened up to embrace wider forms of creativity. So each event in the series will address the idea of comfort, going beyond just like what we call standards as the bare minimum or lowest common denominator, to question how we measure comfort beyond a one size fits all, and provide it in all its nuanced forms. So the series will act as a testbed for future AA events to see what can be implemented to make all events and other aspects of AA life more accessible going forward as we adjust to what is considered the norm. So for example, to fully instate access ramps, have sign language interpreters, caption all our talks, and remove the invisible barriers to accessing the school, which is all things that we've done on a one-off basis, but never kind of holistically, and would require a lot of investment, but it's kind of very overdue in the 21st century to not have these in place. So we also want to hold workshops following the series for students, tutors, and staff to put these words into action by designing and building interventions in the school, as well as suggesting maybe new policies to make spaces more inclusive. So as Jordan Whitewood-Neal, who's one of the participants and who's been helping us kind of shape the series based on his research into how the AA has negotiated disability and access over its history, he wrote in the REBA journal that while the plurality of agendas at the AA has been described as a well-laid table, it may well need to build a new table that we can all sit at. So, I encourage you all to try and join those remotely if you can, or come to London if you're able to, and come sit around the table with us. So from there, to move to the work that I've been doing in Diploma 12, which is the studio I run at the AA with Inigo Minns, we're interested in kind of building worlds that are carefully crafted to bring about kind of urgent change for the near future. But the way we choose to do this is asking each student to shape their own unique form of practice that they can take beyond the world of academia and make real after they graduate. And so I thought the best way to talk about the work of the unit was to actually just show you some examples of projects and practices that have come out of it over the last few years. So to start with, Ioana Mann graduated 4 years ago and was our student over both her fourth and fifth years at the school. And she did a fascinating project about architects engaging with the micro scale to understand the world of creatures, systems, and intelligence that existed all around us, but that were beyond human perception. And so this blurry image kind of shows that kind of micro world overlaid on top of the kind of existing city and how it's constantly blurring and fuzzing and creating things that exist around what we perceive as like solid forms. And so she kind of worked in an architectural office in her year out, but then having done this project and various others, she decided to make her diploma project real after graduation and worked for a practice that sits somewhere between microbiology and design and tested her ideas through a series of independent projects and by applying for different residencies. So in 2020, she was selected as one of the design museum designers in residence, and she explored how architects can design with an understanding of microbial diversity in order to rethink spaces and systems of care and distribute the benefits fairly. And then she now teaches a unit at the AA, and she's been doing other residencies. These images are from one she did with the British Council that involved the creation of new probiotic rituals and an augmented reality app to make us question kind of like how all of this like micro stuff informs what we do at the kind of human or one-to-one scale. So next example is Sebastian Tu, whose project explored how virtual reality technology could be introduced into prisons as a form of rehabilitation. And his project began as an exploration into kind of parallel realities within Second Life, where in order to kind of test the rules of virtual reality as opposed to physical reality, he was looking at how the rules were kind of different. It was all about what you looked like or what your avatar looked like. So if you were like a high res sparkly mermaid, you slowed down everyone's graphics cards. And so people would like kick you out of certain rooms. And so he went to like some sort of fancy party dressed as a duck, which insulted everybody and he had to leave. So he was like really testing these like rules of operation and ways to disrupt these virtual spaces. And this evolved into a complex project that translated the prison system into a kind of multi-level game that could be developed to assist prisoners to re-enter society and to kind of prevent, I guess it was also a way to kind of challenge the British system, which is based on a kind of American system also of like punishment as opposed to rehabilitation. And so since he graduated, he's like now together with his partner, Anna Nicolescu, who was my student in second year many years ago. They've set up their own digital production practice together called Cream Projects. And this showreel is a selection of their projects for a range of clients, including Superflux, the artist Lawrence Abu Hamdan, the fashion brand Aluwalia, and most recently they designed the backdrops for Nubia Garcia to play at Glastonbury. So it's kind of interesting how they've taken this idea of world building and the creation of immersive environments, but used it as a way to talk about identity, culture, and belonging, and a kind of across different kind of creative professions. And then this is like the kind of an example where Jumana Bawazir, like 2 years ago, used poetry and film to construct an alternative Palestinian narrative that reframes the identity of the diasporic community through their collective memories. And what was really impressive about her project was it was a time when there were so many traumatic events kind of happening in Sheikh Jarrah. And she channeled all the anger and trauma to create a really powerful but hopeful project that spoke of resilience against all the odds. So I'm just going to play an excerpt from that, which hopefully everyone can hear.
Dear Palestine, with every voice silenced, our existence is resistance. Haqq calls to all your exiled children to work together, produce, and share your stories, locating its exact origin on your body. Your children are coming together to reclaim our mother.
So yeah, the whole, it was a kind of 10-minute video as our final project. But what was really interesting was that she kind of wrote poetry, interviewed a whole host of diasporic members of different generations and kind of reconstructed their memories in order to construct a homeland that was, you know, almost like not existing in on physical maps and territories, but actually definitely was very present and existed and remained in people's minds. And so it was a really inspiring project that kind of led her to work for Forensic Architecture, where she's been actually trying to look at how through, I guess, these urban interactive urban narratives, she can bring to light how families in Palestine are being forcibly displaced and as a way to kind of raise greater awareness and also hold people accountable. So the kind of last section of my talk is going to move from, I guess, public program and the unit to more independent curatorial projects that complement my work at the AA. And these side hustles, for want of a better word, have been an important way for me to test ideas and kind of develop my own form of practice. And although they're sometimes a struggle to kind of make time for or to juggle all these other things with, they've definitely been really rewarding as a way to kind of also test different forms of collaboration. And you'll see that all the ones I talk about today have been done in collaboration with so many others. So I guess the most ambitious of these was probably the Garden of Privatised Delights, which was the British Pavilion at the 17th Venice Architecture Biennale that I co-curated with Madeleine Kessler. And as most people are aware, it was supposed to originally happen in 2020, but was postponed to 2021 as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. So our idea originally developed from a summer school that we taught back in 2015 at the AA that looked at the pub as a positive example of privately owned public space. Since it was a topic that had frequently been problematized, although little had been done to address its root causes, or to see it as a kind of opportunity for public and private sectors to work together or form new partnerships. And so our idea kind of was to develop these six large-scale installations across the different rooms within the pavilion in Venice. And so this was like a kind of abstract plan of the space. And there's also, as you see in the bottom left corner, a surprise seventh installation, which was a public toilet, or a toilet we put on display in the basement of the British Pavilion, since toilets control the extent to which we can access the public realm, but we never really talk about that. But through making these installations, we were really interested in looking at the ways in which these different privatized public spaces could be opened up in terms of how they were accessed, used, and owned in order for everyone to be able to enjoy them. And so we tried to pick different spaces that you'd find in a typical UK town or city, but then the kind of white shape that you see on the screen was this kind of garden path that we used to link them together so that there was like a kind of defined route that people would take through the space. So the installation spanned different types of privatized public space across the UK. And these were like typical spaces like the pub on the left or the high street on the right. And these were all spaces that were currently under threat, with proposals for how they could be reimagined to become more inclusive. And then we also had alongside these proposed government ministries that look at how our land and data as like tangible and intangible assets could be collectively owned, used and accessed as kind of proposals, which we hope would come to fruition in the future. So each of the six rooms in the pavilion were designed by different practices that were part of our team as a way to use the project as a platform to unify existing research on this topic, but also rather than present it through images, drawings, and models, we really wanted to translate the projects and research on privatized public space into a series of immersive spaces that could be inhabited and explored by everyone who came to visit the exhibition. So we also were aware that like when people come to the Biennale, there's so much stuff on display and there's so much text you have to read. And so we just wanted it to be something that you would experience with your body as opposed to like being exhausted and like just moving through it really quickly. Just to tell you a bit more about the title and things like that, the design of the overall pavilion, from its title to its gradient painting on the walls, to the selection of colors and forms, all took inspiration from this painting by Hieronymus Bosch, The Garden of Earthly Delights. And that used the format of a triptych to frame the middle ground of earth between these two extremes of like heaven or the Garden of Eden on the left and hell on the right. And so when we entered the competition to design the pavilion, we kind of uninhabited the painting and then re-inhabited it as the Garden of Privatized Delights. And we translated those same three panels into the kind of utopia of common land before the Enclosures Act of the 18th century in the UK on the left, and then the dystopia of total privatization on the right. And then the middle ground became this issue of privatized public space as an opportunity or this kind of gray area between these two extremes as a kind of urgent way to create more inclusive, programmed and inhabited spaces. So The pavilion was an amazing opportunity for us to test these ideas at an international scale. But I guess what was really incredible was to finally see our ideas and collective effort realized in Venice after all the kind of trials and tribulations to get there. But then because of the COVID restrictions in place at the time, a lot of the what we hoped would be really active, engaging kind of things that people could climb on, sit on, you know, interact with, became very sanitized. And so there were like all of these very British signs everywhere saying, do not climb, which was the kind of opposite of the message. We had all these signs telling you to play here and climb here. And then there were all these like institutional signs telling you couldn't do that. So what was really great is that it then came back to the UK and it's now being exhibited in the building center, which is just around the corner from the AA, so I can like visit it whenever I want. And it's meant that a lot of people can interact with the exhibits in the way they were originally intended. And it's allowed a lot more people who would never have been able to travel to Venice to actually see the show and visit it in a way that usually we don't bring exhibitions like that back to the countries they were created for. So that's been a really nice experience. But I think more exciting in the long term is actually the conversations that getting a commission like this enables with writers, thinkers, practitioners, and policymakers that really could turn our ideas into actions kind of in live public spaces. So one example is the Public London Charter that was being developed around the same time that we were commissioned to design the pavilion by the Mayor of London's office. And this is part of the London plan. And it was the first attempt to regulate like owners, managers, and users of all types of public space, regardless of whether they're publicly or privately owned. And it was like trying to think about what should a public space look like that could be used by all Londoners. And I guess it's about, there were some, the principles of the charter, because it's really tiny, so you may not be able to see it, are kind of ensuring that ownership is always transparent, so you know who owns it and who to contact, depending on what you want to do in that space. That its use was unrestricted, so that there, like what looks like a public space, you should be able to protest in, or you should be able to do whatever you would ordinarily be able to do in something that's titled public. And that its design is welcoming and community focused. So we were put in touch with the team developing this and they contributed to our catalog for the Biennale exhibition. But in turn, we were also able to contribute to many of the conversations that shaped the charter and how it would be deployed across public spaces in London. And then this, I guess, led to me applying to be, this is like a funny class photo that was taken a few months ago. But I applied to be part of the second cohort of the Mayor of London's design advocates. And their aim is to ensure that quality buildings and public spaces that benefit all Londoners are at the heart of the capital's recovery from the pandemic and also beyond, just in general. And even in the short time since I've been appointed, it's been a really inspiring initiative to be involved with alongside so many people I respect and admire. This list of people is going to go on for ages. And like because my last name begins with V, my name's right at the end. But it's like, I think so many of these people around here are people I've known from before or have gotten to know through this. And it's like a really inspiring network, but also a great way to kind of involve people in the shaping of cities. And so projects that I've been involved with so far include the High Streets for All challenge that's unlocked funding for high streets across the city to apply for in order to realize projects and open them up and transform how they're used in order to engage wider communities. And this is something that we were looking at in the pavilion kind of as retail moved online and public funding's been slashed. High streets, which are kind of present in every kind of UK town and city, have become these kinds of dead areas. And like we've lost like the post offices, the libraries, like all the things that bring people together. And so a lot of high streets are kind of developing innovative new community spaces that could exist and kind of respond to kind of contemporary needs. And so the mayor's office is giving them funding to develop these. But in parallel, what's really interesting is that they've created these networks of support. So if you're a high street that doesn't have any ideas that could be developed, you can still attend these kind of regular meetings that are programmed where the high streets that have the ideas and have gotten funding present that back to you and then help you come up with ideas so that you can unlock funding in the next phase. And so that's been really interesting to kind of enable new possibilities across the city and ensure that like everybody kind of gets an equal chance to kind of develop their high street. And then another project was this kind of urgent research project that's currently underway to look at the safety of women and girls and gender minorities in public space. And Publica is the practice that's been commissioned to work on this by the Mayor of London. but there's several design advocates like myself who are advising on what should be considered and included in this in order to ensure that it's really taking this topic and like thinking about the ways in which we have to think about the design of public space, not just as a series of check boxes, but as a way to kind of involve women, girls, gender minorities, et cetera, in these processes to understand how their experience can shape the way we do things. And being involved in projects like this has been so rewarding, since they've been a way for me to actually see how the ideas we explored in the pavilion can become a reality or can be translated into equitable ways of occupying the urban realm. And so I'm really looking for, it's like a 3-year term. So I'm really looking forward to like all the other things that this role can enable me to do. And then since 2020, I've also been, I think during the pandemic, I was just stuck at home. So I thought I'd just say yes to everything. And so I've been working on a new South Asia gallery for the Manchester Museum in partnership with the British Museum. And my title is interpretation specialist, although for a long time, I didn't actually even understand what that meant. And it became like a catch-all for all sorts of things. But it's really trying to understand the visitor experience of the gallery. And it's been a really incredible but complicated project, since the gallery is being designed by some friends of mine, so Studio C102 and Mobile Studio Architects. And its contents are being co-curated by over 30 local South Asians and South Asian enthusiasts in Manchester. And they don't often see themselves reflected in contemporary culture. So this South Asia gallery is a really amazing project. But for me, I guess as a South Asian or part of the South Asian diaspora, I've learned so much about my own culture and my own identity through even getting to work on this project. And my role involves thinking about how visitors will experience not just the gallery, but also the many complex stories about South Asia. And I guess about the collectives that have, all these stories have grown out of the collective's own research and lived experience. So I think doing a co-curated project at this scale for a permanent gallery is something quite unique. And I'm really excited. It's supposed to open in February next year. And I'm excited to see like how it will be received, but also how it will continue to evolve over the many years to come, because the idea is that there'll be multiple iterations that can change over time. But what was exciting about this project is that it really helped me embrace that my form of practice doesn't really involve maybe drawings or 3D models, but instead is the creation of images, diagrams, presentations, spreadsheets, forms, but ultimately maybe new forms of it or formats of engagement to create participatory projects and practices. And so if I was to define it as a kind of form of architecture, it's an architecture that encourages communication and tries to invent the best ways of doing that, whether it's through words, media, exhibitions, events, or performances. And in many ways, this project has helped me put a name to what it is that I've spent a lot of my career working on and draw these different strands together. So, I mean, because of the pandemic, I couldn't go to Manchester that much, but the collective have been incredibly resilient, and kind of we met on Zoom so many evenings because they all have like full-time jobs or students, and they like really span so many different professions and forms of experience. So it's been a really exciting kind of process to be part of. So I guess returning towards the end to this idea of practice, I felt it was important to talk about how I was never really sure what kind of career path I was going to go on, since I decided not to go back to working in architecture offices when I graduated from the AA, having finished my diploma. And instead, I followed one of the best pieces of advice I received in my final year at the AA from the director at the time. His name is Brett Steele. And he told me not to do just one thing because I would be bored. And so instead, I should do lots of things. And I believe I've taken this advice to an extreme in some cases over the years, but it's made for a really interesting, exciting, and ever-evolving form of practice where I constantly learn new things and have to face new challenges. And this advice kind of came full circle when I received this envelope from the editor of like Blueprint magazine a few years ago, where instead of my job title, because I think he couldn't remember it, it simply said to Manijeh Verghese, who does lots of things. And I think, to be honest, it's probably a better summary of my job than any title or business card. But it took me a long time to try and understand, like in a world where you're constantly being labeled or people want you to define what you do, how do you explain what form of practice you do and how that's still considered architecture? And so I've only recently decided to embrace the fact that it's a kind of curatorial practice that kind of tries to connect people, ideas, and spaces in order to think about the way people experience a space or experience an idea and what forms of engagement will allow them to participate in that. So I'm constantly trying to like rethink that or figure that out with other people through different projects. And so I think it's something to think about, that practice doesn't have to be static, but it's something that you can define and continue to define going forward. So one story that actually altered my career path quite profoundly was when I listened to a talk when I was a student by Indy Johar, who runs Architecture 00, but also Dark Matter Labs. And he was developing at the time a lot of what he's known for today, which is really thinking about systems and ways to intervene with these complex systems. But he talked about being commissioned to design a lunchroom for a school that had run out of space because its numbers of students had expanded, and they didn't have space for all its students to sit down and have lunch together. And they analyzed all their existing spaces and their new plot of land and the budget to create this like a bigger lunchroom, etc. And instead of designing that, he said that all they needed was a new school bell that could like ring at different times to stagger lunch breaks, and they could use their same amount of space but to allow everyone to eat lunch at slightly different times. And all his peers thought he was really foolish because he lost out on a commission to design a really expensive building, and instead he just designed them a bell, or he bought them a bell. And but he said that what actually was smart about it was that he got so many more commissions out of it. And he said that his words were that the answer isn't always a building. And this advice really blew my mind, because when I joined the AA, it was like I really thought that architecture was really about kind of designing buildings. And it was the start of me realizing that architecture is so much more than that. It's a way of viewing the world and making evident the connections and relationships between entities that aren't always apparent in order to create new ideas, spaces, and experiences. So to leave you with some advice that I've learned along the way, especially for the students in the room, I'd say always enter the competition, since you never know what might happen. Maddie and I decided to enter the open call for the British Pavilion when we were actually in Venice visiting the previous Biennale. And we were walking around the Giardini, and we thought it'd be fun to just enter and test some ideas together. And we never, I mean, funnily enough, the open call was announced shortly after we got back. And we spent a month brainstorming ideas and preparing our entry. And in the end, 69 teams applied and 9 teams were shortlisted and to present to a panel of experts from across the profession. And several of our friends were shortlisted, and we didn't even expect to get shortlisted, let alone win. So it was kind of crazy. And as the process was underway and we kind of our idea developed further and further, we became really attached to it. And I remember being really upset the night before they were supposed to contact the winner, because I thought, oh, we're never going to get this, and I'm going to have to like think of another way to make it happen. But it just ended up being the kind of right idea at the right time with the right panel judging it. And so I guess the important takeaway is that although this still feels totally surreal to think about that it's actually happened, I guess it's always worth trying and taking that risk if you have a good idea. And also don't be afraid to try new things or apply for opportunities that you think are beyond your abilities. So last year, someone in the professional practice course I teach asked a great question about failure and how like a lot of people coming into the course talk about all these big projects they've done and how easy these successes and highlights seem to come to them. But what about failure? And I think what's really important is to know is that I applied for the pavilion at a time when I felt my career was at a standstill. Like I wasn't sure what my next move would be. And I kind of applied for this and so many other things at the same time in the hope that at least one of them would work out to get me out of a kind of rut. And while it's been the most amazing opportunity, it's also been quite a journey. Like there's been many unexpected obstacles, both COVID and non-COVID related. And you can probably see the difference. So on the left is us in 2019 when we first got commissioned, and we're excited, but you can see that we're a little bit scared because we had no idea how we were going to deliver this project. But then on the right is us when we finally, after all the COVID delays, we weren't allowed to go to the opening because of like how awful the COVID situation was in Britain. And so we finally, halfway through the Biennale, got to go and sit outside our pavilion in August last year. And it felt like we both aged considerably, but we'd also grown a lot. Like we'd learned so much through this and grew in confidence through all the many kind of challenges, difficult decisions and setbacks. So while winning was exhilarating, soon after it was like replaced by a lot of kind of fear that whether we could deliver such a massive and complex project for an international audience. But it was really amazing to get to figure it out together and also with our incredible team, but also through the generosity of the profession, since so many of our peers and our role models were reaching out to offer advice, support, resources, and more. So this project was definitely only possible through that network of collaboration and support. So I think the important part of taking risks is knowing that you also have this bigger network that will support you going forward. I would like to say that you shouldn't underestimate the long-term impact of your diploma project or your final project. you won't realize it now, but in my case, it's definitely been a project that I think about for a long time to come. My project's probably been embedded in every project I've done, every brief I've written, every competition I've entered since graduating. And I don't know whether this is conscious or unconscious. Like, most of the time I'd say it's unconscious, but I think 3 years ago when we first got the Pavilion Commission, someone asked me about the relationship between my diploma project and our proposal for the British Pavilion. And I'd never really thought about it, but then I thought about my project, which was this, it's like the book on screen is a detective case file, and it was inspired by these 1930s murder mysteries that were made by Dennis Wheatley, where all of this evidence was bound into the book, and you had to, like, the reader became the detective and you had to look through the evidence and solve the mystery. And then there was a sealed section in the back where you'd find out the answer. So I made this kind of architectural mystery as my project. And it was about the search for this elusive room in a city where all the rooms were exclusive and you couldn't access them. And so it's kind of interesting because the Pavilion actually explores privatized public space as something that's become increasingly inaccessible and looks at ways that they can be opened up to be used by everyone in new and exciting ways. So in many ways, your final project is a culmination of your time in academia, but also a manifesto for your practice in years to come. So yeah, to conclude, I wanted to end with this quote by Kevin Lynch, which has given me a lot of comfort over the years. I remember after graduation, I felt a lot of pressure to be on a traditional architectural path, but I realized and continue to remind myself how important it is to give equal value to different forms of architecture and to forge your own path, which doesn't always feel very straightforward. I can tell you that from my own experience. So definitely take risks, and most importantly, don't waste time worrying about where it's all heading. I've learned that practice, if mine is anything to go by, is something that continually evolves through experiences and projects that you either seek out or sometimes surprise upon. And I like the fact that I usually have no idea where it could lead me next. So while you may feel like you're operating on the periphery of the profession, it's important to remember that edges are often paths as well. So thank you. And I look forward to continuing the conversation with everyone in the kind of, I guess, in the rest of this session.
Thank you so much, Manijeh, for that inspiring lecture and advice, which I incredibly found eye-opening, especially as a student. I'm sure a lot of us have questions, which we'll hopefully get to hear. Good evening, everyone. As Professor Mark Raymond introduced me, my name is Patricia Bandora, and I'm currently a master's student at the GSA, who will be facilitating the question and answer session. The first two questions which we'll have are from students from the GSA. Before I open up the session to the public. However, in the meantime, I encourage people to write down their questions in the chat. The first question we have is from Olive from Unit 19. Olive, you have the floor.
Hi, thank you so much. Thank you, Patricia. Thank you so much for your presentation. I really appreciated it as a student. I'm really interested in, you know, this idea of publicness and lectures and exhibition. And I have two questions. So should I, you know, give both of them, or do you prefer if I give them one at a time?
Maybe start with the first one and I can answer that, and then you can move to the second one.
Okay, cool, great. So my first question is, how do you define practitioner? And is this definition flexible and actively inclusive? Does it include a range of people as outside of what we connotate the word practitioner with? So for example, people who do not have formal or university qualifications but have mastered their discipline, people who may not have officially registered practice or role in academia, but have other possible informal forms of practice.
Wow, so I think that's a great question. So thank you for asking it. And I think that, yeah, I think definitely the ways to define words in general should be flexible and should enable multiple readings. I think, I mean, just even from my own experience of practice, I think it's something constantly changing, and what I thought my practice was sometimes even a few days ago is completely different to what I think it is today. I also think a big thing of what I think the role of the architect should be is bringing people together to sit around a table to expand who can be part of a conversation. And too often, I think architecture as a practice is too exclusive, and we use a lot of complicated jargon. We act as though only architects and other kind of built environment professionals should be around the table. But the people who actually use the space are the people who determine the success of a project. And they're the actual experts in a lot of the cases. But I think a lot of the stuff I've been doing, especially with the mayor's office right now, is to think about how do we visualize processes? Because in the UK, the RIBA stages are even written in language or are presented in ways that are kind of impossible to engage with or understand where you can participate in. And consultation in architecture projects has become like a box ticking exercise, where if you just ask people some questions, you know, you've done your job and engaged the community. But actually, if you really allow people to come into the project in multiple ways or enable them and empower them to actually be part of the project will be so much more successful. And I think expertise is really, it should be defined more by lived experience rather than any form of qualification. Like, I think the AA especially as a place is interesting because, I mean, I graduated with a diploma. Now people who graduate get masters, but I don't have like a degree because at the time we were an independent school that didn't offer degrees. I'm not the whole academic structure in the UK of being an associate lecturer, senior lecturer, et cetera, doesn't exist there. So I think you have to find ways to take pride in what you do beyond those kinds of titles. And it's been a kind of real, opportunity for me to also think that, to question why as a profession, we need to seek, a recognition from all these different labels. But it is problematic. I think there's so many rooms where you can't get into them unless you have the right criteria or you have the right. I mean, for so many years, it was like you had to have the right gender and the right ethnicity, et cetera. And that's still definitely the case. And so I think that's why I'm so interested in not just in privatized public space, but in lots of different spaces. What are these barriers that prevent us from all being together? Is it the language we're using? Is it the narrow way we're defining practice? Is it who's not at the table? And I think it's about asking questions like yours that will actually expand both the profession, but also the ways in which we can work together.
Thank you.
That kind of started to answer that question.
Yes, no, it really does. And I couldn't agree more. It's definitely really great to expand that. And I think to lead into my second question, you said, sometimes language can be the barrier that, exists. So in terms of the lectures, my second question is, in terms of how the lectures are structured, I'm not sure how they are structured particularly and how they engaged with as lectures, but both in the word as well as the practice, are lectures the best kind of setting for the type of discussions you aim to have? And does the naming of something as a lecture already kind of exclude particular members of the public, or even exhibition, insinuate to certain groups that this is not something that's either for them or that they would be interested in? I really enjoyed the shopfront exhibition because I think that starts to, already kind of break that barrier where people can already start to engage from the outside. But yeah, that's the second question.
Yeah, I mean, I think that question is something that, I'm still trying to figure out. And I think what I'm lucky with the AA is that because the events are free, I can take a lot of risks. I don't have to sell tickets to things, or I don't have to invite just like the big name speakers that are going to draw. I think there's lots of 2,000 seat auditoriums that people have to fill. Whereas I think while I'm always anxious that I want people to come to the lectures, I also want to make sure that they're not people just sitting back and passively listening. I want them to be engaging and being in conversation. And more of the things I've been trying to organize over the last few years, I think the time of someone standing up in front of a room, even what I've done today, I think it's so much more interesting, being asked questions and expanding the topic further. So a lot of the lectures I organize, I've been trying to minimize the presentation bit as much as possible. Although if you ask an architect to present for 10 minutes, they'll usually present for 20. So it's hard to balance that. And then trying to prioritize conversation. But even the arrangement of the room makes a big difference. So I've been trying the new standards conversation that we're organizing this coming year, instead of having everyone even looking at a speaker or looking at a series of speakers around a round table, we tried to make the whole room into a round table so that everyone's sitting around one table and the audience and the speaker are kind of all equal. And and the hope is that it'll become a discussion where everyone participates. And just trying, that was one barrier that we were also trying to think about, how do we remove these? I think a lot of these lessons I've learned as well through that kind of project I'm doing in Manchester, thinking about how in so many spaces of culture, so many of us aren't reflected. We don't see anything that links to our identity, and therefore we feel like those spaces maybe aren't for us, mm-hmm. or there's price tags attached to them, and or other ways in which so much could be reconfigured just to almost draw people in who would never think about coming to those spaces. And a lot of the people in the collective have really been thinking, like, how would their nieces and nephews or their parents actually want to come in and be part of this process or engage with it? And a lot of what they've been looking at is how things leave these spaces of culture and actually go to the people who we want to bring in, rather than expecting them to come to us. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of community engagement needs to do more of that. But that takes time and lots of effort. And so it's about kind of building that into processes as well, so that that can happen in a really meaningful way. So I think it's something that's actually really changing right now. But yeah, actually, weirdly, I just started talking to somebody a few days ago about whether we should continue to call things lecture series or whether they should be called events, or what are the other ways, or discussions, conversations, like what are ways that kind of break down this idea of like the lecturer as an expert talking to an audience who are just sitting there listening, as opposed to it being much more interactive.
Great, thank you. I really, really appreciate those answers. Thank you so much.
No, thanks for the brilliant questions.
The next question is from Henry. I think I'm pronouncing it right. Henry, you have the floor.
Thank you. Hi, Manijeh. Thank you so much for your lecture. I think it's really cool to see like the different ways in which we can practice, especially like still being a student. It's motivating me to still just carry on, even though, you know, there's so many opportunities out there. So thank you so much. So your work, and especially I think the Garden of Privatised Delights that you did, it pushes the boundaries of what public spaces are and how those boundaries can be extended. And so I think not everyone in the public might be open to the reimagination of these spaces, or the rethinking of these boundaries. So how would you say we can enable, I think, non-designers or non-architects or non-practitioners to experience these spaces in new ways? And in that, how do you define the success of that project for you?
Thanks for the question and for all the kind things you said about the project. I think, especially in the Garden of Privatised Delights, so much of what we were trying to do was to think about the fact that even the way people experience architecture exhibitions, like if you put a lot of drawings and models in there, a non-architect or a non-designer can't participate to the same extent as architects. And a lot of people who go to the Venice Architecture Biennale are architects, but one of the previous curators of the British Pavilion told me when I was applying for the competition that the second biggest audience that visits the Biennale are Italian school children. And which like kind of blew my mind, because like none of the exhibition is designed, like none of the kind of wider Biennale is designed with them in mind. So they're having to like almost like try and understand like a really complicated kind of show by architects for architects. And so why we decided to make these immersive spaces, but also I think drawing back to my previous comment about language being important, we also tried to think about signage, because a lot of the signage in public space dictates what we can and cannot do. And most of it just is telling us what we can't do. So there's all these signs that say like no running, no ball games, no dogs allowed, you know, residents only. There's like so many rules about what we can't do in public space. And so we tried to change the language of the signage in our exhibition as a way to think about how, if we change the language of signage in public space, would that kind of remove all the conditioning we as inhabitants of cities have? Like we're so polite as well in the way we occupy space. We like think there are rules even when there aren't any, because we're so used to being told that we can't do things. And so our graphic designers who we worked with came up with this typeface that was like using finger painting to almost suggest that you can make your own signs and make your own rules. And we were trying to encourage people to like loiter here or play here, or play loud music. Just trying to think about like, what are the ways you can really make a space feel like your own or take up space in different ways. But I think a lot of it is, I think, valuing the expertise of the architect in trying to like make the individual citizen or inhabitant of a city, I guess, aware of what they can, like what their tools are at their disposal, like what's their agency to take over these spaces or to take up space, like not to just leave them there and expect that they'll do that anyway. But then how do you work with them? How do you, as I was saying in the previous answer, like how do you make a process visible so that there's multiple ways they can enter it and be part of it? And signage is just one of them. I think like understanding like who do you contact to organize an event? How do you speak to the landowner to open up a kind of gated square? Even if it's for a couple of weekends a year, at least it's like a way to test out new things happening and maybe over the long term, open up those spaces properly. And also not thinking that there's a one size fits all solution for any of these things. So in the UK, at least often the answer to any kind of public project is let's give them a green space because that's, we always need green space. But in a lot of communities where they don't have time or they don't have the resources to maintain that space, it can become a really antisocial space, a space of crime, and a really problematic, dangerous space for people to walk through on their way home. And so I think by really speaking to the people who will use that space, it can become all sorts of other things that they might need more. And understanding legislation, I mean, there was a summer school at the AA several years ago taught by Finn Williams and David Knight that kind of took all the planning legislation and they drew it as really simple diagrams as a way to kind of make it more accessible to the average person who wants to plan an extension to their house or try and change something about their immediate environment. But as they started drawing, as the students started drawing the legislation, they found all these loopholes that enabled them to do all sorts of things. So like all these like ways in which you can work around the law. And so this book ended up being published of all their drawings and it's called Subplan. And it's a really amazing resource even until today. So I think just opening up some of the things that feel like barriers at the start can change the way everyone can participate in design processes. But I think in response to the last bit of your question, which is what defines the success of the design for me, I think it's best expressed in this quote that we used in the in our application for the pavilion, which is kind of a one by Jane Jacobs, who said that cities have the capability of providing something for everybody only because and only when they're created by everybody. And I think that that kind of goal that you really involve the people who'll be using it in the shaping and making of their spaces, but that they don't feel at a loss for how to participate, but they actually feel empowered that they can, is what success would be for me.
Okay, awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the question.
I'm now opening the floor to any other questions. You can raise your hand or write down your question in the chat. Yeah.
Don't be shy. Please ask me a question.
Mark, you may ask a question.
Oh, you're on mute, Mark.
Right. Sorry, thank you. Yeah. I wanted to ask you about the school and your role in the school and whether you feel, you know, because your practice encompasses so many things as you've described. Is the school support, do you feel the school itself as an institution is a supportive environment for you, or do you feel yourself having to kind of work in spite of it?
I think the school has been a really, I mean, the AA is, I guess, a place that I went to study at for a few years and then never left, but like my role is constantly changing there. And I think what I really like about the school is that it's a way for me to test ideas in a kind of safe space before taking them out into the world to do like a kind of bigger project. So like I think a lot of my ideas began at the AA, whether it was my diploma project or even the pavilion began as a summer school that Maddie and I taught together there. And because it's not a huge institution, there isn't a lot of, I guess, red tape or bureaucracy that I have to go through in order to make things happen. And so I think especially during the pandemic, like moving things online or trying to find ways to do exhibitions outside. We did an exhibition called A Playground for Non-Humans, where we were trying to like do something in the spaces outside the AA that people could come to at different times, but we live streamed so people could like experiencing it from everywhere in the world. Or our end of year show ended up being like a 12-hour Zoom call that was across time zones. I mean, these things were insane. I think the small team that worked on them probably like still has like PTSD from working on Zoom for that many hours. But they were kind of an incredible challenge, and they enabled new ways of thinking and talking about architecture that I probably couldn't do anywhere else. It's a really interesting question, because I think as I've started to do all these projects outside of the AA, they're kind of competing for my time and attention. But in a weird way, I feel like the AA constantly throws up new challenges and like makes room for me to do these other things in parallel that I really enjoy. But I'm not sure how much longer I can keep doing all of them simultaneously. So at some point, something will have to give. But I don't know. I feel like the AA will always be part of my life in some capacity. I just don't know what will come next.
Heidi, do you want to ask your question, or should I ask it for you?
Okay, I can ask my question. Hi, Manijeh. So nice to see you.
Hi, Heidi.
To your presentation, and you're just really, really inspiring. I think my question for you, and I'll just read it off the chat here, is that you also seem to stay very true to yourself and to your identity, being South Asian. And I think what I wanted to know is, how do you navigate that and try to bring that and try to bring who you are into your work? Do you try to do that? Is it something that you actively do?
Well, actually, it's a really wonderful question. And it's something that I've thought about more and more. And I mean, I grew up in India. I was born in London, and I moved to India as a child, and I like studied there, and then only came to the West again, like I guess for university. And I think because of that, I hadn't really encountered racism and things like that growing up in India, because everyone looked like me. And it was only when I went back that I realized like it was so subtle at times, but then also so difficult that it didn't even occur to me when I was a student that I could use my lived experience to shape my projects. So when I look back at some of my projects, they tend to be quite, I guess, neutral in that regard. Excitingly, it was coming to the GSA and seeing the work that students were producing there that was so shaped by their lived experience, but still spoke to an international audience and felt incredibly urgent and relevant, that made me realize that maybe I should be doing that more, and I shouldn't be seeing my identity as just something that sits in parallel to the projects I'm doing, but that actually it's a unique perspective that can shape what I do. And so it's something actually only recently I've been trying to incorporate more into my work. And actually the South Asia Gallery project, while it's still very much a work in progress, is something that's really helped me figure that out to some extent. But even in any project, like how do I use my lived experience, but also the people around me to think about like who isn't at that table, who isn't being considered, like who are the voices that aren't being heard that need to be involved in the process? I think one thing I've realized is that no one has all the answers, that it's actually important sometimes to just to acknowledge that you're still figuring it out. And I think, especially when it comes to your identity that's always changing, or that people are constantly trying to see you in one way or like put you in a box to say, like, you know, I remember people telling me I'd left architecture or I worked in admin. And, you know, while I do a lot of admin work, think of architecture as a very expanded thing, I don't think any of those labels necessarily apply. And so I think it's really difficult to try and navigate around all of these weird things that society tries to like label you as in order to better understand who you are, but rather to like let your work help do some of that talking for you. I think it was very lovely to hear you say that I'm being true to myself, because I constantly try, I'm questioning what I'm doing or what I could be doing differently. It's great to see you, Heidi. I think it's important that all of us just test stuff like that out. But it was really like, I guess so many of you at the GSA who helped me see that there's a way to do that and really inspired me and continue to inspire me. So it felt really, I guess, personally important for me to do this lecture today, because it's really transformed the way I see my practice and how identity can shape practice in a really important and meaningful way that I hope, I think all of you are doing amazing things and will continue to do that on a kind of international scale. And that will make a lot more people realize that they can do that. And I think so many of those lecture series that I talked about at the beginning, from new canonical histories to new models, so many of the people who come to those lectures, they're not necessarily even just students from the AA. They were students from like other schools in the UK. And then when they moved online, students all over the world. Because I guess the way, I guess education hasn't quite caught up with the way all of us are working. And I think you guys are really lucky in the GSA, because I think that is actively trying to think about how identity shapes practice or the way we do projects. But I think so many students at the AA, I remember saying to me, like, they didn't even know they could do projects about who they were or how their identity could really inform that, or what the resources were for how to do a project like that. And I think what's exciting is that's really changing, although some places are slower than others to catch up. And I think you guys should be really proud of the fact that, like, you're leading the way when it comes to that. And all of the rest of us are kind of learning from you.
Thank you so much for answering my question. And just to again say that with you sort of presenting your work and describing your practice, I think you inspire a lot of us to do the same and to also be able to just be truer to ourselves. So I just wanted to really commend you on that and say thank you again.
Oh, thank you. I think it's really scary at times, like, because you're really putting yourself out there and you're being vulnerable in a way that if you're just designing something generic that could be anywhere, like, you don't have to. And in some ways, I don't know, I've been really struggling with this, with the South Asia Gallery project, because all of these people have dedicated so much of their time, but also gone through their own personal histories and a lot of their, like, family's traumatic experiences in order to tell these stories and build the experience of this gallery. And I think it's like, it's almost on the one hand unfair that they're having to do that, but on the other hand, kind of empowering that they get to tell those stories. And it's also kind of interesting that all these objects from kind of museum collections are kind of being combined with their own personal objects and artifacts. So I think it's going to become a really interesting model, but at the same time, part of me just feels for them because they also need to be supported and to tell those stories. And in the long run, so many people coming to the gallery will feel a lot of pain and emotions in general. And so, yeah, I think it's also about balancing between like using your own identity to shape your practice and projects, but also looking after yourself in the process. And there's a new models lecture by Pride of Arabia that was about collective care. And it was such an amazing lecture for me to listen to because they talked about the act of receiving care being almost harder than giving care to other people, and reminding ourselves of that is really important.
I think people are still shy to ask questions.
I mean, or they're probably just hungry to have dinner.
Most likely. Okay, I can ask a question maybe, perhaps.
Yeah, sure.
So I think it's very interesting, even in your lecture, you spoke about, you know, architecture being this like not conventional thing, right? It's like multidisciplinary. You can represent it in many different ways. And I think it's very important to consider that in an African context. Most of our histories aren't very documented. And I think it's a bit overwhelming for an African student now to start documenting our histories of through architecture. And I guess I'm asking for like advice. So for someone that's, you know, just finished university and wants to, I guess, document that history, but also try and infiltrate different spaces and make it accessible to other people. I know you spoke about language. But are there like other ways we could do that? If let's say we're not choosing a path of like going straight into like working in a firm, but rather doing what you do, which is everything, or side hustles as you called them.
Yeah, I mean, I think ultimately I tell all my professional practice students this, because a lot of them like want to stay in the UK but have to sort out visa issues, or you know, it's great to talk about how you want to do all these other things, but you need to ensure that they pay you properly as well. But I think there's so many grants and like funding sources out there that enable you to So I guess just buy yourself some time and space to actually think about how you want to document these histories in a new way that doesn't require you to like maybe subscribe to the way Western models have documented histories previously, but actually could allow for something much more interactive and like contextual and relevant to kind of whose histories you're documenting to happen. I mean, I spend a lot of time trying to find some of these opportunities as well. And I mean, I think the Graham Foundation that currently is like funding so many forms of research, but there's so many smaller, like there's an exhibition that we're going to do at the AA called As Hardly Found that's being curated by Albert Brenchard Aguilar, who I think may be on the call. So he has gotten funding from so many sources and has been trying to fill gaps in the kind of colonial archives of the Department of Tropical Studies of the School of Tropical Architecture. And so much of what happened there was documented, but then also so much amazing stuff, especially around artistic practice, wasn't documented. And it's, I think through like his amazing ability to communicate his research agenda, has been able to access so many sources of funding and also to commission artists to kind of think about how to fill those gaps in exciting ways and speculative ways. So yeah, I would encourage you to do the same. And I think it's great that you're thinking about that already. But I think also there's so many different forms of media. Like I think in the selection of student projects I showed from even my own teaching, I've been really impressed by how my students have found ways to carve out space to do their own practice, whether that's working for someone who's doing something similar part-time and then applying for residencies and for grant funding and things like that, or finding ways to work the system to enable you to, like, I think my student Seb applied for like this exceptional talent visa so that he wasn't tied to an office, but then could start his own practice. So yeah, I think a lot of it is trying to find loopholes, but also, or trying to find funding, or trying to find ways so that you can do your own thing. But yeah, I guess, I think I started out doing three things, and then I was very anxious that I would just get stuck doing those things forever. But then slowly but surely, one of those things got replaced by another, and my practice evolved over time, and all of yours will as well. I think like you definitely have something to say, so it's just about figuring out the best way to say it and like what are the right tools to use to test how to say that and who to test that with. Sorry, these are all very long answers.
Okay, thank you for that. We have a comment from Sarah. She says, so wonderful to see you back in the space and all the beautiful things you have created since we all saw you. Congratulations, and so wonderful hearing you and seeing the way you see work, practice, and the spaces we occupy. Thank you. Sarah de Villiers. Yeah.
Thank you, Sarah. I wish I was there, but hopefully I'll see you all soon.
Do we have any more questions, comments? Doesn't have to be a question. It could also be a comment.
Or if people don't have questions now, they can also send me an email or get in touch with me.
Yeah. The awkward silence.
I mean, I have to usually be in your position during lectures where I'm waiting for people to ask questions, so
yeah.
I feel your pain, but
yeah, okay. I think then if there are no more questions, then we could conclude the question and answer session. I guess I'd have to say thank you on behalf of the GSA and the students for coming to speak to us. We wish you were there at International Critics Week, but we understand why not. Hopefully we'll see you in person sometime, but thank you so much for sharing your work with us.
Thank you so much for having me. And yeah, I'm really sad I can't be there for International Critics Week, because the first time around it was so incredible and like completely changed my life. So Hopefully there'll be other opportunities for me to come there. And I wish you all like the best of luck with all your projects. And I can't wait to see what comes out of the school this year. And hopefully there'll be other ways for me to see your work, either online, or I can maybe see it in exhibitions and stuff elsewhere. But
hopefully.
Yeah. Thank you very much. And hopefully see you all
soon.
Thank
you, Manijeh.
Thanks, Mark. Thank you for inviting me.
And thank you, everyone, for coming. Have a good evening. Oh. Bye.
Bye.
Silence.